take a second and picture this scenario. It's 2016. You're in the basement of your friend's house, and the two of you are playing video games, as you do. And you're both big fans of the Vlambeer game Nuclear Throne. It's an underappreciated roguelike shooter with an even more underappreciated soundtrack. A soundtrack so good, in fact, that even when you're not playing the game, you often get the urge to listen to songs from the game in the background. And so, you open up YouTube in browser, because at this point your friend's iPhone 4 is more than half a decade old and struggles to operate even the most simple of apps. You type in Nuclear Throne Where the Gun's At, one of the best songs in the game, and you think, oh weird, a Betamix? I didn't know there was a beta version of the soundtrack. And you're greeted with this. We'd been tricked. To my knowledge, this was my first exposure to Death Grips, but more importantly to this video, it was my first exposure to the concept of a musical mashup. At least, as far as I know. Here's the thing, by 2016, mashup culture had already made its way deep into the fully ironic meme humor landscape of the internet, to the point that when I heard it, I wasn't all that shocked by the idea of mashing songs together, I was just more surprised by the fact that this channel had tricked me. My brain processed the music as just another meme, like the many others I loved at the time. But the thing is, mashup music isn't just memes. What I didn't know at the time was that mashup music and the culture that surrounds it has been around for decades and has influenced both music and the general cultural landscape in a way that's honestly pretty difficult to calculate. Today, let's talk about where mashup culture has been, what it means, and ultimately the genre's path forward to an even more exciting future. There's a lot of potential answers to the question, what is the first mashup? The first track I ever heard mentioned in that regard was 1988's Doctor in the TARDIS by The Time Lords, which was a critically panned combination of the Doctor Who theme song with Gary Glitter's Rock and Roll Part 2. As funny as this one is, though, it's not even close, actually, to the first. In fact, there's some debate as to whether the first real mashup came just 5 years prior or a whole 20. The very first recording I was able to find that could be called a mashup is a song by American singer-songwriter Harry Nilsson called You Can't Do That. In theory, it's a cover of a Beatles song of the same name, but the track fairly immediately diverges into a cover of many songs from throughout the Beatles' discography. Nilsson apparently got the idea by playing a simple chord progression and thinking to himself, huh, I feel like I could make something with this. So, he ran out to a music store right before it closed, bought a Beatles songbook, and made the track that night. It definitely stretches the modern definition of a mashup, which we'll get to later, but there's no denying that it laid a lot of the foundation. The second one, which is far more akin to what we would now consider a mashup, was released in 1983 under the name Do It Again Medley with Billie Jean by the band Clubhouse. Make no mistake though, rather than a more traditional medley format, these two songs are combined in a way that is eerily similar to the kinds of remixes we hear nowadays, seamlessly blending the classic Steely Dan track with the obviously iconic Michael Jackson track to create something new. This is the simplest, most pure form of the mashup, combining two or more songs to make something new. It was the mid-2000s, though, where mashup culture really came into full form, with more major releases like the Linkin Park and Jay-Z remix EP, Danger Mouse's fusion of the Beatles' White Album and Jay-Z's Black Album, naturally titled The Grey Album, and of course, the classic Pet Sounds in the Key of D. This string of releases, alongside some other individual tracks and, of course, the advent of YouTube, solidified the mashup as a cultural movement more than a novelty. Possibly the most important release for mashup culture on the whole, however, wasn't a piece of music at all. Rather, it was the game Guitar Hero, and especially its competition Rock Band, that broke down the technical barriers holding creators back in a major way. See, one of the most important parts of creating a mashup is isolating the different tracks from each other so you can combine them with the isolated elements of other songs. For example, if I wanted to, say, put Wonderwall's vocals on I Want It That Way, which I definitely do, I couldn't just put my MP3 file of one song onto the other. Even if I did pitch correct them to put them in the same key, it would still sound like an absolute mess. Instead, I would need to isolate the vocal track to completely remove any other instrumental elements, making it sound far more natural. The thing is, this wasn't exactly a simple process. Nowadays, you can do it as easily as just uploading a file to a website and letting that do it for you, but back in the day, chances were you'd need an officially released instrumental version of the track to essentially cancel out the instrumental entirely, leaving only the vocals. It wasn't an easy process, and God help you if you wanted to isolate just a single instrument from the rest. This is where Rock Band comes in. See, every song in Rock Band, as well as every song in Guitar Hero Past 3, has the isolated stems of every single song in its track list, which allows the game to make that instrument not sound when you miss a note in-game. The mashup community was very quick to realize the potential in this and started ripping out the individual instrumental tracks for every single song, using these as the new standard for mashups. The most prominent proponent of this technique is Neil Cicierega, who to this day has been releasing albums in his Mouth series, which are all composed entirely of these Rock Band stems, most prominently All Star. These records are long, winding, and strikingly conceptual, weaving these samples together into tracks that are quite metatextual without losing the ironic absurdity of it all. It's genuinely great music that also revels in the meme culture surrounding it. Most mashup music isn't like that, though. That's not a negative, just a fact. Conceptual mashup music is an exception to the rule for the most part, largely due to the fact that mashup albums in general aren't standard. The genre really came into fruition in the late 2000s to mid-2010s, an era less interested in albums and records, and far more taken with the idea of music on demand, with YouTube streaming and iTunes selling individual songs for like a buck a piece. Because of that, you were far more likely to find an individual song made by some random person on YouTube with 100,000 views than to find a full 50-minute project. While there was definitely a sense of humor in the mashups at this time, it's also striking how genuine it all feels in hindsight. These were passion projects made by a single individual out of a love of two songs, a love that was intense enough to drive them to learn audio editing and to mash them together. In the later 2010s, though, I feel like that changed. There are a lot of things you could attribute that to. Most obvious in my mind was Gamergate's effect on internet culture, but that's a whole other video that I frankly don't want to make. What's important is that it was around this time that the internet's sense of humor became fully ironic. Genuineness was to be mocked, and the only humor to be found had to be so abstracted from meaning that it became just a tool to elicit a reaction. The late 2010s was the era that kind of changed the meaning of a meme, and with it, somehow, it took the entire mashup genre down with it. The effect of this was fairly immediate and became even more prevalent with time. It resulted in a wave of mashup artists who were only in it for the meme. Keep in mind, this is the era I got into mashups with, and I still hold a lot of respect for these artists. I name-dropped Siva Gunner at the beginning of this video, but I'd be lying if their work feels like it displays any sense of passion or love of the material. The channel is literally founded on a practical joke, and once you've heard six or seven high-quality rips, you've heard more than half the jokes and samples they're ever gonna use. It's Seven Granddad, it's Snowhalation, and it's those goddamn Flintstones. That's not to say that there's nothing good that came from that channel, but when you have been uploading 1 to 2 videos an hour since 2017, there's no way I could be convinced of the passion in the project anymore. The works are still artful and certainly don't lack talent behind them, but they feel empty in comparison to what we had before. Another artist who I feel resigned himself to that same aesthetic, only to finally break out in later years, is William Morency. You've seen at least one of this guy's videos, I imagine. They're all titled fairly straightforwardly and tell you exactly what the mashup is in the thumbnail. I find a lot of his stuff leans a bit too hard into like the meme-y territory to really get lasting enjoyment out of, especially at first, but I must say that thankfully over the past year or so he's managed to break that and make some of the most fun mashups on the internet right now. These two in particular are genuinely transcendental and pay beautiful homage to the artists involved. They elevate the tracks rather than break them down with cheap gags, striking a perfect balance between comedy and celebration of music. The other thing that happened in the early to mid 2010s that I find very interesting is the advent of Vaporwave, which coincidentally the internet tried to douse in irony the way they did with mashups, see also Macintosh Plus, but ultimately failed as the genre continued to push forward pursuing the idealized aesthetic of 90s consumerism and vaporware in innovative new ways. Vaporwave is a genre that, for the most part, is made up of bits and pieces of other songs and pre-existing sounds to warp and tweak them into something new. It often uses reverb and distortion and filter effects to evoke a feeling not necessarily present in the original songs to change their meaning. Now, I don't claim to be a vaporwave expert or even a massive fan of the genre myself, but doesn't that sound familiar? The last part, about taking old songs and making them mean something else, into pieces that, despite being composed almost entirely out of previously existing material, craft a new experience? When I really think about it, what's the difference between these two genres functionally? Hell, what's the difference between mashup music and, say, Plunderphonics? Is the distinction between these two records really so significant that it warrants a whole new genre, especially when one of these genres is hailed as a great innovation in modern music and the other is left to the wayside as a joke, a little plaything to be consumed like junk food? There is a technical answer to this, of course. The reason that vaporwave is distinct from mashup music is based on more than just vibes. Vaporwave artists take a lot more liberty with their samples, twisting and shattering them and then rearranging them into something more abstract. Where in mashups it's almost seen as a faux pas to mess with the samples too much, that's standard fare for a vaporwave. When it comes to Plunderphonics as a whole though, it's where I start to get a little indignant. The Avalanche's debut record, Since I Left You, is rightfully hailed as one of the greatest albums ever, and far and away the most acclaimed Plunderphonics record. It's this celebratory tapestry of music from all over the place. You'll hear literally thousands of samples spanning decades and decades of recorded music. What you won't find, though, is a recognizable sample. The group very meticulously crafted a collection of records that would be totally unrecognizable to almost anyone. But did you know that this wasn't always the case? Did you know, in fact, that there's a version of Since I Left You that is packed with just as many recognizable samples as there are obscure ones? It's called Gimmicks, and it's the reason that the whole Plunderphonics versus mashup distinction bugs me so much. It was released as a DJ mix 5 months before Since I Left You, and is halfway composed of tracks that made it onto that album. The other half, though, is songs that either didn't make it onto that record or had to be heavily edited to clear. these songs are compositionally no different from what we hear on the album proper, but the songs they sample are far more popular. Jimi Hendrix, Cyndi Lauper, The Beatles, De La Soul, The Smiths, and so many more are all over this thing, all treated with the same care and affection that every sample on Since I Left You received. And, almost unanimously, Gimmicks is regarded as a mashup record, whereas Since I Left You is Plunderphonics. One is left to obscurity, while the other basks in the glorious acclaim allowed by its genre's title. With literally no change to the formula, just the pieces the puzzle uses, it gets to be part of the more legitimate genre. Put simply, if it samples songs we don't know, it's Plunderphonics. If it samples songs we do know, it's a mashup. As time goes on, those lines get blurrier and blurrier. If you saw my Best of 2021 video, you'll know that I absolutely loved Death's Dynamic Shroud's record, Faith and Persona. That album is ostensibly a vaporwave album, but if you listen to it, it sounds absolutely nothing like a vast, vast majority of vaporwave. It sounds a lot more, to me, like a slightly more intricate form of a mashup, from the Kelsey Ballerini sample on the opener to the Olivia Rodrigo on the closer. It's a little more chopped up and messed with than on your typical mashup track, but it's too obvious and especially too clear to just be standard vaporwave. Once again though, where I think this record could have been an amazing point of legitimacy for mashup as a valid genre for true and powerful artistic expression, the tag's nowhere to be found. Instead, once again, it's being thrown in with vaporwave because of the group's past work. But right at the beginning of the year, the first day even, an album came out that I feel firmly cements a place for mashup in the Plunderphonics discussion. Not content to go on just being a novelty, this record paves forth a path that I suspect mashup artists will be following pretty closely going forward. It is single-handedly the inspiration for this video, and frankly, it's been the soundtrack to my entire year so far. Meet Kakola. If you're deep into music, or are a regular user of the site Rate Your Music, you likely came across her breakbeat album from last year, A Gift to Us All. She tends to jump around in genre a lot from record to record, including her own dive into vaporwave on Flower, and somewhat bafflingly, a 2-plus-hour-long progressive electronic concept album about the Undertale character Chara. What I want to talk about today, though, is her Rose series of records, and especially her latest release, Ruby Rose. Getting this out of the way now, this is unquestionably my favorite musical release of the year so far. It's not even close, to be honest, and I almost doubt another album will release to top it. It's almost disappointing to see the year peak so early, literally the first day, but Ruby Rose displays such once-in-a-generation talent and ear for musical synergy that I can't be anything but in awe towards it. There's very little music that I think can really be spoiled, but I think this is one of them. If you're looking for a recommendation, I'll put it this way. Album length is a massive deal for me, and at 80 minutes, I was super nervous that this would be bloated, but by the last song, even though it was almost 4 in the morning, I was dreading the end, wishing there would be even more. I was lucky enough to get the chance to speak with Kakola extensively throughout the process of writing this script, and it was absolutely fascinating to hear her talk about her music exactly the way I had been to all my friends, with passion and genuine love and excitement, even after having spent hours and hours playing those songs to death while making them. Ruby Rose's tracks are crafted with such an obvious passion and love of the sourced material that, if nothing else, it would be impossible to call it a joke. When I mentioned this obvious passion, she told me that there was only one song sampled on the whole thing that she doesn't genuinely love, Katy Perry's Roar. And even for that one, she said that putting it over a Eurobeat instrumental basically fixes the song, and she loves it now.
I don't sample Nickelback to make fun of them. I sample Nickelback because I fucking like them and want to bring out the aspects of their music I think are good in a new context.
It throws away all the cynicism and blatant irony of the past decade-ish of meme mashups, though she has told me to clarify that she does not have anything against meme mashups, and evokes the very early internet fandom-y brand of mashup, the kinds you'd find in old AMVs, with all the silly but wholeheartedly sincere energy and the song choices you'd expect to hear in a modernized version of that format. And let's talk about some of these song choices, because frankly, it feels like this album was explicitly made for me. It's ridiculous. It literally opens with Dream Theater's Pull Me Under, 15-year-old me's favorite band, puts Call Me Maybe over it, a song that even in its lowest point of cultural relevance, I have always defended, and then throws in the guitar from Franz Ferdinand's Take Me Out, one of the first songs I ever learned to play. From there, the personally targeted samples don't get any less frequent. Head Like a Hole, My Own Worst Enemy, Music for 18 Musicians with Everlong played over it, are you kidding me? And then you throw in Diary of Jane for good measure, and then that transitions into Prodigy's Smack My Bitch Up, and you're like, fuck yeah, this is a little obvious of a pick, but I'll take it. But then she throws you for a loop and is like, haha, just kidding, here's actually the best Prodigy song with Omen. This is all one track. No exaggeration, I am genuinely in awe of the fact that this exists, and that someone other than me had this exact taste to create it before I could. There's no greater testament to this than the final track, Bouquet, in which she basically expands on Adam Neely's video about the Paramore versus Olivia Rodrigo debate, link in the description, and finds over a dozen songs that work within that same framework to make this gorgeous amalgamation of pop punk that legitimately feels like a bouquet of flowers, like the title implies, with copious amounts of 14-year-old me's favorite band Paramore. I'll be 100% honest with you, I actually cried a little bit when she sampled the song Decode, because not only was that my absolute favorite song from the ages of like 15 to 16, but also the way it was used was so seamless and beautiful that I couldn't help but just be fully in awe of both the creativity and relatability of the project. That Decode sample also leads me to another point of evidence for just the sheer passion and love that goes into every track here, and that's the fact that no matter what, she always puts in the effort to make even the most difficult of samples work. It was an incredibly ballsy move to open the record with a Dream Theater song, because the band is known for having fucky key and time signature changes all over their songs. It almost put me off the record at first, because I seriously thought there was no way she'd be able to pull it off, but through some tiny, unnoticeable adjustments that must have taken a ton of tweaking to get right, the track sounds great, and even the biggest Dream Theater fan in the world would have trouble spotting the differences under the mass of other music laid on top. Back to Decode, though. We kind of get a little into actual music theory here, which I'm certainly not all that well versed in, so I'm gonna do my best to paraphrase exactly what she told me, because it does still provide a lot of insight into what the process is making these songs.
The song from Ruby that I sampled changes key from A to D at one point. And like, when songs change key in a mashup, you're pretty much fucked. Like, what songs are gonna follow the same key change? So you either abandon your current combination, or you pitch it up awkwardly and suddenly chipmunk vocal your a cappella. But, as it turns out, Misery Business is in G-sharp and Decode is in C-sharp, which means they are the exact interval apart to match the key change in the Ruby song. It just sounds like Hayley Williams is singing one song because the timbre of her voice doesn't change.
This technical skill comes from over a decade of practice, from the age of 9 on interfaces ranging from FL Studio to GarageBand to the goddamn music creator in Little Big Planet 2. She started off trying to imitate the works of people like Titus Jones, Drokus, Mutant Mixes, and later on Girl Talk, Patricia Taxon, and of course Neil Cicioriga. Titus Jones is one in particular that I want to zero in on, because I actually found his stuff myself while doing research for this video, and considering his maximalist dance floor friendly pop remixes, Hearing Coca-Cola cite him as an influence felt like such an oh duh moment. Other influences outside the mashup scene also play a huge role in the way that the music gets made, of course, even aside from the stuff that is explicitly sampled in the music. The ones that feel the most obvious to me and are corroborated by Coca-Cola herself are artists like Ween, The Flaming Lips, and Björk, who jump around in genre a ton, and especially in the case of Ween, have a sense of humor paired with a genuine talent for music that I see similarly in Coca-Cola's art. Possibly the biggest inspiration and influence for Coca-Cola, though, and this is incredibly obvious just looking at her discography, is fandom. Sometimes it's more outwardly obvious, like on The Angel, the Demon, and A Gift to Us All, which are literally about Undertale and Petscop respectively. A lot of the time, though, it's not exactly a direct or textual attachment to a fandom, but rather an excitement and inspiration that comes from experiencing and fixating on a piece of media. There's a feeling I get listening to Ruby Rose that's pretty much unique to this album. It's this feeling of genuine childlike wonder and awe at the mere concept of music, of the basic facets that make up a song. Coca-Cola backed this up and told me that a lot of what she wanted to capture with this album was a feeling very similar to that. There's this feeling when you're young, hearing and experiencing the world of pop music for the first time, where you feel like anything could happen, anything is possible. You haven't figured out the structural trick of pop music yet, you don't hear the simplicity or the pattern or the markability of it. All you hear is this sheer force of personality and emotion that it conveys. By playing with this and expanding on the structure of pop songs, she told me she felt like she was bringing that feeling to life in a whole new way, for a whole new audience. This context of pure and genuine awe and fascination with music is why I think Ruby Rose is so important, why I think it's the best album of the year so far, and why it feels like this is the ideal future for a genre so often put down as a novelty. Where some artists fail to expand beyond one joke per song, drilling it right into the ground, Coca-Cola deftly avoids going hard on the obvious jokes and memes, instead using that shock reaction as a way of grabbing your attention, and then from there, crafting genuinely incredible music. Listening to Ruby Rose, I feel like I've gained a new perspective on music as a whole. I feel like I love it all a little more, and even if only for a moment, I feel that sense of awe you get from hearing music as a kid again. It's the greatest embodiment of mashup music's legitimacy as a genre, acts as the golden standard for all other mashup music to aspire to going forward, and is honest to God, one of the best pieces of music I have ever heard.